So, who are you and what do you do? Welcome to the show.
Yes, hello. My name is Krzysztof Urbaniak, and I'm a Polish organist, a teacher. I'm teaching at two music academies, in Łódź and also in Kraków. I'm also an organ expert. I have a position of the organ expert of the Ministry of Culture and National Heritage of the Republic of Poland. And of course, I'm also doing things like writing articles and books on historic organ building and performance practice, making editions of notes, of music, I mean. And one of the very important fields of my activities is Baltisches Orgelzentrum in Stralsund, which is a society that trying to focus its activities on documentation, preservation, recordings also, and restorations of historic organs in the Baltic region, let's say.
Wonderful. You're all over the place, right, Krzysztof? it's such a wonderful thing that at this age, of fairly young age, I would say, like me, right, you are doing so many things for the organ world, not only for Poland, not only for the Baltic area, but I would think for entire European cultural heritage also, right?
Well, because you say a lot, connected. Of course. I personally believe one should try to learn his own background very well, mm-hmm. and then you can go, so to say, to the people and try to make discussions, and then you would of course discover things which you have in common with them. Yes.
So, Krzysztof, we are meeting here in Vilnius University, St. John's Church, early in the morning, and just yesterday, I know you had a splendid lecture about 18th century Gdansk organ culture, right? And it was very successful. I had my student observe this lecture, and he was very fascinated by the topic and by the discussion and by your presentation. So I'm glad you came, and thank you for your time, and you're very generous.
Thank you very much. Well, what shall I say? I tried to do my best, and of course, this lecture was also connected to the idea to promote a new edition of the Kohlwerks by Daniel Magnus Groner, which was prepared by my colleague Martin Ross from Stralsund and by me, and of course co-edited by the Music Academy of Łódź. So I brought this edition as a present, so to say, to the Music Academy of Vilnius, and then I thought it would be maybe appropriate to say something, to show some pictures, to show some recordings, and to discuss the issue. Yes.
Fantastic. I think you should be. Let me tell you. Let me ask you this: are you living in Gdansk right now?
No, not at all. I'm. You know, I'm every week between Łódź and Kraków. Mm-hmm. So it is central and southern Poland, and Kraków is 600 kilometers from Gdansk. But Gdansk has been really one of the main fields of research, mm-hmm. of mine, and of course there's this organ in Pasuęk which has been restored recently also under my supervision, and it is an organ from Danzig because it was made by Andreas Hildebrand, who was one of the main figures in the 18th century, so somehow I feel connected to this place, of course. Yes.
Do you get this feeling when walking in the ancient streets of Gdansk that it's 300 years ago, organ builders, organists, organ masters worked there and created these masterpieces that are still present up to this day in most of the cases, right? Which makes this beautiful city so unique in the world, right?
Well, yes and no, because Gdansk has been, you know, heavily damaged in 1944 mainly. Mm-hmm. Of course, the organ cases as such, most of them have been kept safe, because there was a group of German architects, it was called Baustopp Keibel, and they had this great task just to document to make measurement, to take measurements, and just to dismantle organ cases, and also three complete Baroque organs, and just to put them in safe places in small villages. Yes, of course. But this is the past. So Danzig is such, of course, is unique in terms of the splendid ensemble of organ cases. But in terms of preserved instruments, well, not much has been left, mm-hmm. of course. So if you want to talk about the style and type of an instrument from Gdańsk, you really would have to also take a look on what is standing, maybe still preserved in some villages, smaller cities around Gdańsk, mm-hmm. and even, you know, in a quite wide circle of 100 kilometers, yes. Mm-hmm. And, of course, to go back to your question, if I'm thinking about the organ builders, yes, very much. And I also have many reasons for this, but if I were supposed to make a summary, and just, you know, in a synthetic way to present this world of the organs, one would probably have to say that there would be three main directions from which the ideas came to Gdańsk already in the 16th century, because then, well, if we start in really the last quarter of the 16th century, you have this magnificent organ from St. Mary's, which has been made between 1583 and 1585 by Giulio Antoni from Friesland. Giulio Antoni Friese, of course, this is today Holland, partly, at least partly. And, of course, Johann Koppelmann, his apprentice, also representing this line, would later come to Vilnius, so you have a direct connection, of course, mm-hmm. to Vilnius. Then you have this group of North German organ builders like Johann Helwig, who would come to Danzig, to Gdańsk from Lübeck, so really representing this kind of circle, and also some German-speaking organ builders who are active already on this territory, like the organ builder Fischer, for instance, or Thiele, many of them. And then you would get this second direction originating from the south, from Krakow, with Jerzy Georg Nitrowski, the father of a really great organ building family, over three generations at least. They started really their career in Krakow and in what is today Slovakia. And then they would move from Krakow through Warsaw to Gdańsk, and Jerzy Nitrowski would settle down in Gdańsk in 1649, and he would bring the really new set of ideas, for instance, the string stops, the solitionals, which were unknown mm-hmm. before this point in Gdańsk, would be suddenly present in almost every single instrument, and a large amount of 8-foot stops, as in this organ, of course. Mm-hmm. So this direction from the south would dominate the scene in Gdańsk maybe until 1710, 1715, and then you get the third direction, which partly originates from Abschnitka through his master apprentice, Meistergesell Johann Balthasar Held, who was also an apprentice of Georg Nitrowski. So you've got this connection, and then Johann Balthasar Held would have some kind of, unfortunately yet unclear, connections with Andreas Hildebrandt. We know that both of them were working in Koszalin on an organ in 1779. And then you can see suddenly in several organs made by Andreas Hildebrandt in Gdańsk, great similarities to the organ cases and some details of construction with the organs of Schnitger. So really, the Netherlands and Northern Germany of the 17th century, then you get the new air, so to say, from the south, and then a bit of Abschnitger. So that's what, in my mind, defines the world of the organs in Gdańsk in the 18th century.
And even visually, right, you have these wonderful small towers that we don't have usually in Lithuania, for example, or in eastern part of the Prussia, because we have to remind our listeners where Gdansk is, right? On the Baltic Sea, Baltic Sea, where the territory of West Prussia was, right? It was the centrum of that culture, right?
Yes, of course. Well, the political situation, of course, is a bit, you know, fragile in Gdansk, because the city, from the formal point of view, belonged well, at least to the partitions of Poland, formally, as I say, to the Kingdom of Poland. But from the ethnic point of view, it was absolutely dominated by the German-speaking population, also with some portion of Dutch people, and some, but not very substantial, number of the Polish-speaking community. So this interesting mix of Germanic culture under, let's say, Polish administration, partly. But I was having a very nice conversation with Eric Winkel from the Flentrop organ building company last week, and he just told me that he didn't know that, for instance, there were mayors of Gdańsk which were simply Dutch people, and they would be really reading Amsterdam newspapers. Mm-hmm. And if you, for instance, take a look on the 17th century drawings, just showing the city, the silhouettes from some distance, you would see, of course, that it got fortifications totally after the Dutch manner, in the Dutch way. So really a lot of influence from different parts.
And these multicultural and cosmopolitan even ideas probably are remnants of the old Hanseatic tradition, right?
Surely.
It was the
yes.
Middle Ages. Do you remember in which century it was the most prominent feature, the Hanseatic League, basically?
Well, I would say this idea was already, well, belonged to the past in the early Renaissance. So the best time would be the late medieval time.
Late medieval, yeah.
And if you, for instance, try to analyze the situation of cities like Lübeck, you know, one of the most important Hanseatic cities, it would be very clear that most of the most spectacular buildings and objects of art would have been created really at this point of time. Mm-hmm. At this point of time, but Gdańsk had its prosperity time maybe in the 16th century.
16th century, right?
Because the city is dominated actually. Well, of course you have these Gothic churches, great churches like St. Mary's or St. John's or St. or Holy Trinity, is of course. But I would say, you also get a lot of Dutch Renaissance, and you have these Dutch architects like Abraham van den Blokke and Isaac van den Blokke. And really, Gdańsk was the main harbor city of Poland. Mm-hmm. At this time. So many products would be transported through the Wisła River, which starts somewhere in the mountains and goes through all the main cities. And then you would have in Gdańsk places just where corn and some metals from the south, like lead, different kind of products, wood, timber, would be stored, and then they would be sold. So this was one of the main sources of income, I would say. Mm-hmm. of Gdańsk, well, to my understanding at least.
And this, for example, these churches in the 18th century, you mentioned in Gdańsk, did they have lots of composers writing for the organ at the time?
Or yes, as far we know, yes. In the well, already in the 17th century, mm-hmm. because if you, for instance, analyze what was happening at St. Mary's, the main church, well, you had this pupil of Jan Pieterszoon Sweelinck, Paul Ziffert. Then you would also have a student of Johann Jakob Vorberger, Ewald Hinz. And of course, I could continue this list quite for quite a long time. Well, if your listeners, if our public today would be interested to get some more information, I would simply recommend to read this book by Hermann Rauschning, which was published already in the 30s, about the music and the music culture of Gdańsk.
I'll make sure I'll add the description of that book into the description of the podcast so that people can find it online too.
And now to go back to the 18th century, because this should be our main topic today, I would say there were at least two very substantial figures. The first would be Theophilus Andreas Volkmar, who was born in Stettin at this time. Mm-hmm. You know, so he must have grown up in the shadows of the Schnitger organ in St. Jacobi. There. Then he would move to Gdańsk and he would start his career as organist of the Holy Trinity Church. Then he would move to St. Catherine's. And we have six organ sonatas by him, which are quite curious because they are having a very substantial pedal part. So almost in a very excessive way it's being used. And there is a funny story because Volkmar did not get his position at St. Mary's because during the examination, he, as has been written by the examination committee, he treated the pedals of the organ in the most unfriendly way, which would be very dangerous for the instrument itself. You know, and if you get a look on these sonatas which have been published actually recently, very recently. You would understand what is meant. So really, not a very substantial, maybe manual part, but extremely complicated pedal part.
It's such a rare occasion, right? Because usually, normally, organists would play maybe virtuoso things on the manuals, and maybe a few notes on the pedals, right? And therefore, their instruments would lack big organ pedal towers.
Mm-hmm.
Which is not the case in Gdańsk.
Yes,
right?
It's exactly the opposite, mm-hmm. because you have very big, very substantial pedal divisions, at least 10, 12, 14, and even 18 stops, like at St. John's and St. Mary's and St. Nicholas. But to go back to the composers, and then you have probably the most important figure of the 18th century, Daniel Magnus Gronau, who was described by his successor at St. John's, Mr. Gleimann, as the most beautiful musical spirit, musical ghost almost today, that has ever been present within the walls of the city, mm-hmm. of Gdańsk, of Danzig. And he must have been really quite fanatic in terms of working, because he created a lot of music, and this music was believed to be lost until very recently. Anyway, he tried to compose a kind of lexicon, a kind of encyclopedia of choral variations. Mm-hmm. So he probably spent all his life just writing variations. And after his death, the Church of St. John's, the community, just decided to buy all the manuscripts from his sister, mm-hmm. All the manuscripts which were remaining after the death of Daniel Magnus Gronau. And then it turned out that alone within the choral variations you had two very substantial volumes, and one of these was preserved until around 1946, and some of the cycles of choral variations of Gronau have been published already before the Second World War. But then, you know, the source disappeared. And it was really a coincidence, a total coincidence, that together with Martin Rost, we found traces of a microfilm of the second volume, preserved at the Newberry Library in Chicago.
Mm.
So somebody, we still do not know who, and it was really impossible to identify this person, brought the original book, the original manuscript, to this library, and it was simply microfilmed. And then the original disappeared again. So the only thing we have is the microfilm, which after some struggle of, let's say, how did you say this in English, I mean, de jure, so to say, the of juridic nature, yes.
Mm-hmm.
I'm not sure if this is it, right.
Yeah, de jure, I think,
yes, let's say,
people understand
of them. Of this nature, well, it was possible to use it for an edition. And we got fantastic help from Dr. Krüger, from Ortus Verlag, a German editor, of course. And at the end, we got two volumes with almost 500 pages of organ music, which is very substantial, mm-hmm. extremely substantial. And what you have there is a vast collection, not only of music, of many different kinds of variations, and almost all of them are using a pedal as an obbligato part.
Mm-hmm.
But also, to my knowledge, the biggest ever created collection of registrations.
Mm-hmm. Indication. Indicated in the score.
He's writing almost in every variation, with exception of every first variation in his cycle, but all remaining variations have very precise suggestions, what kind of stops the organist is supposed
to
use.
So what? You know, let's recapitulate. You know the music, you know
yes.
the composer, you know the registration.
Yes.
Do we know the organ itself?
Yes, quite well.
For which it was written?
Yes. It was... well, first of all, we would have to say if and why we are able to connect the registration to a certain organ.
Uh-huh.
If you make a list of all the stops which are listed, well, which occur simply in the indications of Gronau, and if you compare it to the stop list of his great organ at St. John's, on which he was, you know, active as an organist for many years, almost 20 years, it will be very clear that actually, with exception of maybe some three stops which are not mentioned in the music, you got the same stop list, basically. So a connection can really be made. It was an organ which grew up, so to say, and which was enlarged several times. It started, well, its history started around 1626, maybe, when a new organ was built by Merten Friese, who was probably the son of Julio Antonio Friese, already mentioned today.
Mm-hmm.
And it would be a three-manual organ, Hauptwerk, with a 16-foot principle, so really a big organ, and a Rückpositiv with an 8-foot principle, and a free independent pedal division, some 12 stops, if I remember correctly. And then, towards the end of the 7th century, there would be some changes in the stop list, mainly created by several members of the Nitrovsky family, also mentioned today already. And this stop list, unfortunately with some mistakes, has been documented by Johann Mattheson in 1721
mm-hmm.
in his appendix to his edition of the treatise of Mr. Need. I mean this treatise on the thoroughbass, how
mm-hmm.
to play and how to figure out the way in which the thoroughbass could be played, presented, realized. And in this form, this instrument would be known to Daniel Magnus Gronau. And at the end of his life, around 1744, and we know that he died in 1747, Gronau let his organ be enlarged in a very substantial way mm-hmm. by Andreas Hildebrand. And it was done in a very clever way, because Hildebrand added two massive pedal towers, so that the pedal division got 18 stops. So really a lot of foundations, 5 16-foot stops, and a Posana 32, and so on and so on. And these pedal towers, of course, could not find their place in the main, you know, nave of the church, so they had to be placed in the side naves. Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. So you got a very wide structure, almost 20 meters wide, a very great distance.
Fantastic.
And then if one thinks that Ronau is composing his variations, for instance, also for pedals alone, and one imagines this great distance of let's say, the C and the C sharp side, you know, of the pedal or organ, well, it must have been very interesting, and it must have been a very lively experience to hear, you know, the sound coming from such a distance. And what's also interesting, we know that this pedal organ has a very progressive compass up to F1.
Oh, that was very so rare. Very,
yes, yes, not many organs mm-hmm. Had this in this region. Well, of course, the small organ of St. John's got the same compass, but it was after the death of Gronau. But, for instance, the great organ of the cathedral in Königsberg, made by Johann Josef Mosungel in the 20s, also got this very interesting compass.
Mm-hmm.
But still, it was a very rare occasion.
So you could play Bach's
F major
toccata.
Right. Yes, yes, yes. So we know quite a lot about this organ. And what happened to it? It was totally rebuilt around 1900 by this famous Valka organ building company from Ludwigsburg in southern Germany. But the organ case with the original front pipes remained, and then it was somehow saved by Baustoffkabel from the fire of the church. They just dismantled the organ, and now partly, unfortunately, without the pedal towers, the main part of the organ has been mounted in St. Mary's mm-hmm. in Gdańsk as the main organ, with a stop list that resembles a bit a situation from the 17th century. It was an organ created in the 80s by Hildebrand from Altwarmbüchen. Mm-hmm. So that's the story.
Fantastic story. It's such a treasure to have finally find this massive source of registrations, not only for music, but when you mentioned 500 pages of music and registrations,
yes.
Right? That blows my mind, because mostly what we have from that century for chorale variations is probably Harmonische Seelenlust by
Kaufmann. Yes, Kaufmann, yes.
Mm-hmm. But it's not that substantial. It's still
yes.
very, very important, but not on that level, probably.
Yes, that's also my opinion. Of course, the music, well, he is repeating himself.
Mm-hmm.
And probably it would be difficult for a composer who is willing just to write variations on every single melody in the hymnal book not to repeat himself. But still, it has some very live and interesting ideas. And again, I would say that for the sake of education, it is very valuable, because you get many ideas how to create a choral variation with sometimes very simple, let's say, methods,
mm-hmm,
really.
Mm-hmm.
And a lot is also written using thoroughbass.
Mm-hmm.
So, yeah, it's a very interesting thing, surely.
So, of course, when you say chorale variations, first of all, probably Lutheran
yes.
tradition
yes.
comes to mind,
yes.
not Catholic, right?
No.
Was it a Lutheran yes. tradition in that region?
Yes. Well, Gdańsk would be dominated by the Lutheran Church already in the 16th century,
mm-hmm.
so there were very few Catholic churches. And Gronau was organist exclusively in Lutheran churches. He started at the small Lutheran chapel, St. Anna's Chapel, standing just mm-hmm. nearby well, actually being part of the Holy Trinity Church. Then he would move to St. Catherine's as the organist of the small organ, because there were in the main churches at least two organs, and I can tell you more about this in a while. Then he moved also to the Lutheran Church of St. Mary as the organist of the choir organ. And finally he got the position of the principal organist of the main organ at St. John's. So he was exclusively working in Lutheran circles, and also he would grow up in the Lutheran tradition, because he was born in Insterburg, which is today part of the Skalingrad-Königsberg region. And that's what I also said yesterday in my lecture. I just show the stop list of the Zickermann organ of the Lutherkirche in Insterburg,
which is no longer
in existence, unfortunately. Right. Mm-hmm. And they, I just wanted, you know, to show in Vilnius this similarity with the organ case of the Dominican Church, and I showed some photographs of a later organ from Insterburg, which is made by Johann Preuss, but that's totally off topic for today. Well, anyway, mainly Lutheran circles. Yes.
Fantastic, and of course Lutherans really love to play the pedals, right? While the Catholics,
yes,
probably would play mostly manual stops, is the case mostly in Italian tradition or South German tradition. They would add some of the pedal,
yes,
parts, but not too substantial. Whereas Northern European tradition,
yes,
would expand, and therefore we see these enormous pedal towers.
Yes.
So tell me a little bit how they used pedals. Was it, when you say obbligato,
yes,
was it just cantus firmus or pedal solos or any other techniques?
Yes. Many ideas.
Mm-hmm.
A lot is written as a trio, where you simply play a totally independent voice on the pedal.
Mm-hmm.
It's quite difficult, actually, so you really have to practice this. Then you get variations with cantus firmus in the pedals, just in longer notes, and very often with a very standardized registration. And then you get variations for pedals alone,
mm-hmm,
and it's always made in the same way that the pedals is just that the right foot is playing the cantus firmus and
right,
the left foot is playing, let's say, counterpoint.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
Actually, it's not a real counterpoint, because it is a one voice texture, but just let's say. So this would be the choral, and the left hand is just playing the counterpoint, let's say. The counterpoint,
mm-hmm,
let's say. But I would like to go back to your statement about these pedals in the Catholic tradition, because that's very interesting. Because, for instance, in Vilnius, you have had, and you still have, this tradition of very independent pedal division
in
Catholic churches. And also, very far from here, in southern Poland, for instance, if we have a look on the oldest Catholic organ in Poland, which is now being restored, the organ in Olkusz,
mm-hmm,
it also has a totally independent pedal division. And even if you go to the south, for instance, Slovakia, the
mm-hmm,
Hummel organ in Lavoča, for instance, it already had a pedal that we would probably classify today as a North German idea. And then even in central Poland, the Catholic tradition would make an extensive use of pedal divisions. And even if you think about the organ at the Bernardines Church in Vilnius, in the 17th century, the stop list is very well known. You have a pedal of, I think, 12 stops. You know, with Posaune 16, Trumpet 8, Cornet 2, Bauernflöte 1 foot. So really a totally North German tradition. And the problem is that we simply have no idea how it was used.
Exactly. I was thinking maybe, you know, there was some money and there was some artistic idea from the organ builder, you know. Maybe they asked Adam Gottlieb Kasparini or local organ builders from that tradition,
yes,
also built something big, something exciting, right? And they had the freedom to do this.
Yes.
And enough money too, yes. to include pedals. Why not, right?
Yes, but if you have a pedal division, well, actually you would probably use it.
I hope so, I hope, but we don't know how, right?
Well, we have, from the Catholic circles in Poland, there is an interesting source, music by Adam from Wągrowiec. He was a monk, and he lived in the first half of the 17th century, and he was also an organ expert, so he would be invited to several very prominent churches just to make the examination of a new organ. And there is some music of him. For instance, there's a Preambulum Pedaliter, and he's playing really an obbligato pedal. It's like this. Well, in the manuals you have some kind of structure, and the pedals would be playing. So really, quite a lot to play at this time. So I believe they really have used the pedals. And if you go to the really almost the earliest source, I mean the tablature of Johann from Lublin, which will be probably
right,
also known to
16th century.
Yes,
right.
This great tablature. Well, I had a nice discussion with my professor of from Warsaw, from the time I studied in Warsaw, with Barbara Świderska, really a great person, and she was teaching the Orgelbaukunde, the seminar on the organ building, and also organ organ literature. Yes, and she told me that she analyzed some of the liturgical pieces from this tablature, and these are rather short compositions, because of course in the Catholic context you didn't have as much time and place in the liturgy just to show the organ, but actually the Cantus Firmus is played in the best way if you put it into the pedals. Otherwise you cannot grasp with one hand,
right.
The distance is too large.
Mm-hmm.
So I think it would also be used for the sake of the Cantus Firmus playing. Maybe like in France, like Grand Plongeur, and you have the Cantus Firmus, Cantus Planus in the tenor voice in the pedals. So maybe that would be the way.
Something like Samuel Scheid also said,
yes.
If you have some Cantus Firmus in any voice, you can play it with pedals.
Yes.
If you have 8-4 and 2
yes.
foot reeds.
And you had this possibility in Vilnius. Of course, it would be perfectly possible.
Wonderful. So, Krzysztof, what about today, for example, when you have this music, large volume of 500 pages, can it be used today during the liturgical settings of today?
Well, maybe yes. Mm-hmm. Maybe as a prelude, for instance, but as the melodies are of Lutheran origin, it would be mainly probably be used in the Lutheran context.
Mm-hmm.
So it would be possible to play it, for instance, during the communion, the distribution of the communion, when normally people do not sing, or as a prelude or something like this. Yes, it would be possible.
But of course, after the service, you're free to play whatever probably
you
want. Of course.
And I forgot to tell you some very interesting things about how the organ would be used in the liturgical context at St. John's in Gdańsk.
Right.
Because fortunately, we have something which would be called an Organisten Agenda, which is actually a document specifying very precisely at which point and in which kind of way both organs, the big organ on which the Gronau was the organs, and the small organ in the transept, would be used. So, the way would be, for instance, the organist of the big, of the large organ plays the prelude to the hymn, the organist of the small organ is accompanying the first verse, the organist of the large organ is playing the second verse, and so on, and the very last verse should be played by both organists on two organs, and they should of course make an agreement on the harmony. And I also told this in my lecture yesterday, that there will be some very, you know, substantial consequences if the harmony would not be exactly the same. And even in the 19th century, there is a document from the St. Mary's Church, which was published by Mr. Krishan in the 30s of the 20th century, that the organist should really keep in mind that, for instance, should not pull the stops too loudly and should not create confusion, and of course that they should play the last verse in exactly the same way. But I cannot imagine how it would be possible, how it was possible just to coordinate the both organs if you had a distance of, you know, 60 meters between them, or 50.
Were the both organs in tune, in the same pitch level?
Oh, they must have been.
Must have been. Was it a corton or camerton tradition?
Do you know? Normally it would be the corton tradition. Corners. So 465, normally.
Half normally. Step higher than today.
Yes, yes. But interestingly, if you analyze the cantatas, which are preserved from many churches in Gdańsk, you will see that the organ part is being transposed down, the whole tone.
So, of course, organist had to have a skill of transposition.
Yes,
at least in writing.
Well, it is written. You know, it is written just one whole tone lower already. But there were also cases that. Transposing device would be constructed, and it's a very interesting story because in Poland there are three actually organs which have this kind of construction.
All right, interesting.
And two of them are in Catholic churches. So the first one is the, and the oldest, no, it's not the oldest, but the biggest is the organ in Krzeszów, in Grusau, in a Cistercian church made by Michael Engler from Breslau. In the 30s, 1730, it's a very big organ, you know, like 50 stops, and it has a transposing device for the Rückpositiv, which you operate using two levers. So with one stop, you, so to say, lift up the keys, and with the second one, you just move the mechanics.
Movable keyboard basically becomes, right?
Well, actually not the keyboard, but the mechanism, under
mechanism,
the keyboard.
Okay.
And then you just put the keyboard to the previous position, and you can play in the transposed way. So from corton to camerton, and you also have transposing stops on the pedals for chamber music. And the same construction, solved in a slightly different way, can be found in also a Cistercian organ in Jędrzejów, which is in central Poland. And then it works like this, that this three-manual organ from 1754 has a fourth manual, which is just pulled, you know, towards the organist, and it transposes the Rückpositiv again from corton to camerton, and you simply, you know, I don't know how it's in English, wie eine Schublade, you just pull it.
Right.
Well, photographs of it can be found easily on the net, and then you have the only example from the Lutheran Circus, which is the Hildebrand organ in Passwing. But there, the transposing device has been reconstructed. So the original mechanism is not preserved, unfortunately, but there were traces of it, because every stop of the second of the Oberwerk has additional pipes for contra B and contra B flat.
Fantastic.
Which means that there must have been
a
transposing device.
Well, it's such a fascinating tradition that you had these engineering challenges for the organ builders. You know, what I heard, Adamo Ratio Casparini built an organ with two kinds of temperaments, you know.
With two kinds of pitches.
Pitches.
Mm-hmm. Yes. For instance, the organ he made for the monastery church in Częstochowa, where the two organs had, so to say, registri da camera.
Camera, yeah.
Which means that two or three stops would be tuned in camerton. And also the name, quintadena in camerton, flauto major in camerton. And there is even one organ which is preserved. It is a small organ, which was originally built by Adam Orazio Casparini for St. Elizabeth Church in Breslau, in Wrocław today, in Poland. It's a small organ with one manual and without pedals, and it has some transposing stops, really. So it was just meant to fulfill the function of playing with instruments. Other instruments. Mm-hmm. Yes.
Fantastic. Then you don't have this intricacy of engineering, moving the mechanisms of the of the mechanics behind the underneath the keyboard. Probably you just have to retune the pipes, right? To do a different pitch level.
Yes.
415 Camerton is.
Yes.
Something like that. Fantastic tradition. I just imagine how much it should have been appreciated by the clergy, for example, the wealthy citizens of the Gdansk, for example. Let's take Gdansk, right?
Yes.
Very widespread cultural tradition, right? Lots of organs, lots of music, right? Organ builders, organists who played extremely sophisticated pedal parts, right? It would be a shame if nobody really would appreciate that kind of art, right? So I would think that a general educational level, at least for their audiences, was quite high in that city. Do you agree?
Actually, I have no information about this.
Let's speculate.
So, well, I can only speculate. Mm-hmm. And there would be some Latin schools, of course, in the city, and the young schoolboys, mainly boys, would be, of course, trained in music, and they would have also the function to sing with the organ, just to take part in some musical, you know, performances. And it was the case in the Holy Trinity Church, for instance, where it was really done. Yes, but as for the general level of music education, well, I would say it must have been substantial to a certain degree because of the fact that the people had to sing in a church, so they had to know the melody and have some voice, you know, just to sing.
I just imagine, you know, after this splendid service, maybe on Sunday or festive occasion,
yes,
a member of the congregation would come up to this organ and say, "Oh, I so appreciate
splendid
your pedal,
brilliant
double pedal solo with. I really understood the chorale cantus firmus in your right foot." and Mr. Gronow,
yes,
would say, "Oh, thank you so much.
That's what I meant."
That's what I meant. I played it for you.
But he's, you know, he's actually underlining very often the cantus firmus line with his registration. Because, for instance, if he's writing a trio, the cantus firmus is mainly in your left hand, in the middle voice.
Mm-hmm.
And then the middle voice, well, actually in medio, let's say,
medio,
because it's sometimes very high.
Okay. Mm-hmm.
Anyway, he is actually, in every single case, registrating the left hand with the cantus firmus much stronger than the right hand.
Mm-hmm.
And then you have this paradox that the stops chosen for the left hand are much higher in pitch than these which were chosen for the right hand. For instance, he's taking 8 and 4 for the right hand, and the left hand is 8, 4, 2. So it is really sounding as if, you know, all the possible voices of men, women and children were singing at the same time. And you cannot, you know, you cannot ignore the cantus firmus line. It is simply always present.
And your parishioners, for example, probably they would know it by heart, right? And
the melody, yes.
The melody.
Surely.
That's what it takes. Probably people of today's congregation should really know their melodies by heart. And then, if the organist is clever enough and developed his or her technique enough, then can play and elaborate and improvise on these cantus firmus,
yes,
in very artistic, pleasing ways.
Yes, and I must admit that it is probably much more easy and comfortable to improvise on Lutheran hymns than on Catholic hymns, because the melodies are made in such a way that it is maybe a bit simpler, because Catholic melodies would, to a large degree, originate from the Gregorian chant with a totally different construction, so we are forced to use some different ways of harmonizing and so on.
Well, Christoph, I think I have a feeling that we could talk and talk and very talk long, about for hours,
time.
Right?
Yes, surely.
But yeah. Sadly, our time draws to the end. And of course, I will be very curious to know about your future developments. I wish you great success in digging up the old sources. Maybe you will find volume 1 or maybe volume 3.
Might be.
you see? And maybe even you will be able to initiate some organ reconstructions in Gdansk or other cities in Poland,
yes,
where it's really needed, right?
Yes, well, I hope so. So thank you very much.
Before we end,
yes,
could you please direct our listeners to some place online where they can find you and your work also?
Well, I think YouTube is a nice source. So
YouTube?
Yes. Mm-hmm. And they will also find the website of the Hildebrand organ from
mm-hmm.
Passwenk.
Mm-hmm.
I'm the boss, the chef of the music festival there, and it is an organ from Gdańsk, actually the only one which really has historic material and which has been reconstructed, so you can try out the registrations of Gronau to a certain degree there. They can also find some information about the reconstruction from Olkusz, which is now going on in the internet, so just try and try to find something.
And you're on Facebook, right?
Yes, yes.
Right,
so
right.
So if somebody mm-hmm. would be willing to mm-hmm. to get some kind of contacts with me, yes, of course.
Great. So thank you so much. You're so generous and have a great, wonderful, brave, creative year ahead of you. And I'll be very, very curious about your future research too.
Thank you very much. Thank you.